Our New Testament lesson this week comes from the second chapter of the book of Acts. Allow me to take just a moment to set the scene here so we can put this very, very powerful verse and reading in its proper perspective. Peter was preaching at Pentecost, and you probably remember the story of in the middle of the gathering of thousands of people, a great wind came from heaven, and the people started speaking in various languages and tongues. The Spirit of the Lord was with them, and they began asking questions, and this was part of Peter's response. Therefore, let all Israel know beyond question that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. When the crowd heard this, they were deeply troubled. They said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter replied, "Change your hearts and change your lives. Each of you must be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is for you, your children, and for all who are far away, as many as the Lord our God invites." With many other words, he testified to them and encouraged them, saying, "Be saved from this perverse generation." Those who accepted Peter's message were baptized. God brought about 3,000 into the community that day. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May God add his blessing to this, the reading and study of his holy word. Amen.
Amen. You're going to need a pen or a pencil, something to write with this morning. And while you dig around for that, I'm going to tell you a funny little story. There's a great story about a Sunday school teacher and a little girl, and they're doing some craft work, and the girl is drawing, and the teacher said, "Well, what is it that you're drawing?" And she said, "Well, I'm drawing a picture of God." And the teacher says, "Well, we don't know what God looks like." And the little girl said, "Well, you will in just a second." And so I'm going to ask you this morning to draw me a picture of Jesus. On your bulletin, draw me a picture of Jesus. What does he look like? Are there defining characteristics? Where is he? The confirmation class, where's Debbie? Debbie knows I like to draw Jesus, right? I like to put him in places, and I like to give him a defining characteristic. And then I like to peek over the shoulders and see what's happening. Anybody have a guess of what the defining characteristic at the 8:30 service was?
Serving communion?
No.
Rainbow.
What's that? Rainbow? No. Wow, these are very contextual answers. A beard. That was the defining characteristic of Jesus at the 8:30 service. Anybody have Jesus in a particular place serving communion? Where else? You have him in a heart. Muriel. Maybe I shouldn't give it away, but she drew a heart when she drew Jesus. Anybody else have a defining characteristic or a place for Jesus? Robert's, my husband's Jesus was on the cross. Many people had the defining characteristic was the beard, but when I draw Jesus in confirmation class, I give Jesus a halo, right? The old, the ancient iconography, always gave him a halo, always gave him a circle to say that he was human and divine. Exactly. And that's the question this morning. Is Jesus God, or is Jesus just a pretty cool guy, really, really cool guy? We're in the midst of a sermon series where we're trying to unpack that there are many ways to be Christian, many ways to live out the faith, many ways to understand the gospel, and many ways to conceive of give birth to, right? Jesus, in our lives, and certainly in the life of the church. For some, faith is believing certain things. For some, faith is reciting and saying certain things. For some, it's living a certain way. For some, being a certain way in the world. For some, Jesus is God. For some, Jesus is a very, very cool guy. The issue is a matter of Christology. That's a big and fancy word for how you understand Jesus. And within that framework is a high Christology and a low Christology. If you believe that Jesus is God, you have a very high Christology. And if you believe that Jesus is more human, like us, you have a low Christology. High Christology is also known as a descending one, where the divinity comes down to earth. A low Christology is an ascending one, where divinity rises from Jesus, from the people. First is human, and then is divine, when God's voice comes down. And so I wonder, does the human come first, or does the divinity come first? And I say yes and yes. Both are true, right? Because we learn over time that Jesus is fully human and fully divine, right? Is that familiar language, yes, to you? I think so. It's certainly language that we find in very scholarly circles. And just FYI, that's where I live. I'm pretty much a perfect five on this continuum because I do believe that Jesus is fully human. And in some way, I don't fully understand it, fully divine. And it might be a 4.8, just, you know, if we're going to really be honest, because I'm a little closer to earth than I am to heaven. The ones among us will believe that Jesus is very human. The tens among us will believe that Jesus is God. And if you're keeping track of your numbers over the course of these weeks and this sermon series, where the averaging of the numbers is going to be the really interesting part. Because we're not going to be a pure 5 or 1 or 0.8 or 9. We're going to be somewhere in the middle of it all. United Methodist theology might put us on an 8, certainly closer to the divine, and why might that be? Anyone? There's another doctrine that we talk about, and that is because of the Trinity, right? We believe as United Methodists in the Trinity. You know, we talk a lot about the Book of Discipline, that's sort of the rule book of the church, but do you know that the doctrine, the standards of the church are also there? It might be good bedtime reading for you, and certainly it's not something that you're responsible for reading, but just so we get a sense of what the church might believe. So we can't really forget about the Trinity, but we might want to understand it better, or where it comes from, right? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. What I think is so cool is that this passage from Acts talks about how they baptized in the name of Jesus, right? Paul says we baptize in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. That's that 1 and 3 and 3 and 1, Jesus, not as God or as human, but as Son of God and second person of that Trinity, right? So this is the time that you take a nap, and I'll wake you in a little while, because this just gets a little, it's a little bit more convoluted, but here's the thing about this series. I believe that it's really important that we know what we believe and why we believe it and where all this stuff comes from, right? Sometimes we just rattle off a lot of things to a lot of people, and people are rolling their eyes and wondering, did God really say that? Or did the church make that up? Was somewhere sort of like the Trinity. Because it was in the early 3rd and 4th centuries where they had a number of church councils to decide both of those things. One, the understanding of Jesus as fully human and fully divine. And second, how it is that we made sense of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, right? They needed councils to do that, and those councils were there because of what they called Christological controversy. They didn't get together to have a party because they all believed in the Trinity. They got together because they were arguing about those things in the 3rd and 4th centuries. So give yourself a little permission to fully comprehend and realize that we've been working this thing out and wrestling through this for a very, very long time. Through the language of the Trinity, we get the, a lot of what we recite in the creeds, begotten, not made, right? True God from true God, right? And so you can give it a Google, or you can read about Cyril and the nature of Christ. You can read about Arius and Athanasius and see about their battle in the language of the Trinity. And as good Trinitarians, maybe we want to break out in song. Glory be to the Father, right? And to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
That was there creating the world, that was there, and that
which sent Jesus to be in relationship to us, because that's what we needed. That's what was realized was needed. And so it is that we realize that there are people who believe that Jesus is God, and there are people who sort of prefer the more human among us. And what's so interesting is that, you know, this isn't a problem that we created. It's not a something that we've created just to be, to argue with one another. Because when I thought about the text that informs me the most about this issue, I go to Philippians 2:6, which says that Jesus, who though he existed in the form of a God, did not regard equality with God as something to be grasped. As if Jesus, like, that wasn't Jesus' primary concern. But in the NIV, it reads this way. Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Wow. Really different. And you might even, you know, read a particular Bible because it has the higher personality, because it has a certain point of view. My point is simply, we didn't make this up. Bible interpreters, Bible translators have these concerns at hand when they write their translations. And so it is that there's one last place that we can look to answer this question in the Bible. And this is sort of the way of now I go. We can go right to the cross to realize and identify a human Jesus and one who is fully divine. You might know that the Gospels, there are four, right, in the New Testament. You might know that they're really different from each other. Certainly, you know, the content of Mark is found in Matthew and Luke, and then there's other content there. But in those first three Gospels, what they call the Synoptics, Jesus is a bit more human. There is, in those Gospels, a bit of a lower Christology, and scholars look right at the cross. Because what does Jesus say from the cross in Matthew and Luke? My God, my God, my God, my God, why are you doing this to me? And in John's gospel, with that higher Christology, Jesus says, it is finished. Mission accomplished. This is why I'm here, right? Okay, he didn't say mission accomplished, but it is finished. He knew that's what happened, that's why he came. It's different, right? And here's the most important thing, and here's the why, come on. Here's the why this is important for us to know. Because when Jesus turned around in his traveling ministry, and he turned around at Caesarea Philippi, and he looked back at the disciples, he looked them in the eye and he said, who do you say that I am? Bucky, right? Who is it? Who do you say that I am? I'm not even sure that he cared what the answer was, but I think that there is a certainty that he wanted to know that we knew and that we had a relationship with him. We need to know because he asked us what we believed. We need to know because it's part of who we are. We need to know because we're going to need to share it with somebody else someday. And here's the really, really good news. There's going to come a day when your life gets really, really messy. And you're going to need your Lord to be really messy. On the ground and, you know, unsure and even able to weep. Able to ask the questions why. And be with you in that relationship. And then there might come another day your Lord and your God, on earth as it is in heaven. So where do you lean? Are you none? Or are you two? Who do you say that he is?